Today we're going to be looking at Psalm 65, which focuses on praising God as our gracious Redeemer. And we've been looking at the Psalms and how they relate to, first of all, grief. And so in Psalm 55, which is the Psalm of David, we looked at how David was really dealing with the burdens of life. And he told us in that psalm that we are to commit to God. We're to trust God as we're going through tough times. We're to confide in God in prayer. We are to cast all of our cares upon him because he cares for us. The Apostle Peter picked up on that and writes about it in 1 Peter chapter 5. And then, last but surely not least in regards to Psalm 55 and dealing with the burdens of life, we went back to take note of what was taking place in David's life as he writes that psalm and what happened in the text after, you know, it was somewhat finished. And we find that the prophet Joab confronted David, and what he wanted David to understand was this, that he clearly needed God first and foremost, but he also needed God's people. And so when we're going through tough times, we need God, and we need one another as well. And then we looked at Psalm 73, which is a psalm that really deals with what we refer to as the enemy within. David did not write Psalm 73, Asaph did, who was a great worship leader. And Asaph was having a problem in Psalm 73, and the problem was that he was looking at people who really weren't righteous, were not living for God, were not real believers in Jehovah, and they seemed to be prospering. And so what Asaph is writing about in Psalm 73 are issues that we deal with within. Sometimes no one knows we're even battling these issues. But he's talking in Psalm 73 about greed and envy. And so what Asaph tells us that we need to do is this in dealing with envy and greed. We need to turn to God first and foremost. That was the true turning point with Asaph. He was confused, he was depressed, he was angry, he was upset until he went in to worship God. And when he began to turn to God, we find that then, and only then, did he have clarity and be able to understand somewhat what he was dealing with. Well, the second thing that we talked about with Asaph was this, that Asaph really wants us to understand that we need to see the big picture, and the big picture is God's picture. And so he tells us that we need to think biblically. We can't just think on our own. We're so broken and sinful that we can't be left on our own. That's why God gives us his word, and we need to base our life on God's word. And so when Asaph really began to think biblically, he had a different view of the people he envied and all that they had. Well, number three, Asaph tells us that we need to truthfully be transparent. We need to have a truthful, transparent introspection of ourselves. Instead of looking at everybody else, we need to look at God, and we need to repent of our sins. In fact, Asaph said, when I was pricked in heart, I was brutish and ignorant, I was like a beast toward you. And so Asaph looked at himself. Fourth, he treasured God. He tells us in Psalm 73 that there is nothing on earth that I desire besides you. But for me, it is good to be near God. And so we need to treasure God, his goodness, and how great God is. And then last, but surely not least, he tells us in the ending of Psalm 73 that we need to tell others about God's goodness. So our testimony is not how great and wonderful we are and all that we accomplish. Our testimony is this, that we tell others about God's goodness. And so here's how he closes Psalm 73 in verse 28. He says this, I have made the Lord God my refuge, that I may tell of all your works. Now, today, as we look at Psalm 65, this psalm is not focused on a problem. It's not dealing necessarily with the burdens of life. It's not dealing with the enemy within us, like greed and envy. This is clearly a psalm that is a song of praise. And so what we find in Psalm 65 is David. This is a psalm of David again. And David has penned this psalm, this song that was most likely used at some national Thanksgiving festival. You know that in the Old Testament there were a number of different festivals that Israel would come together and they would celebrate God in some way. Many think that the celebration that David wrote this psalm for was the Feast of Tabernacles. And it was one of the longest and happiest festivals that Israel celebrated. It was a celebration that lasted 8 days, and what they celebrated was the abundance of the harvest crops that God gave to them. And so here's this song of praise. And in verse 13, I was thinking about this even as you were singing today. In verse 13 of Psalm 65, it says this: the meadows clothe themselves with flocks, the valleys deck themselves with grain, they shout and sing together for joy. And so hopefully that's what we were doing this morning. Here's a picture. He's not saying that, you know, the plants and so forth speak, but as we look at them and as we understand that God is the creator of them all and that God has given those to us, it's a picture of us shouting and singing for praise. Some of us shout because we can't sing, but there's no excuse, is there? We shout, we sing with joy in our hearts. And that's what we need to do. So in this psalm, David is focused on how great, how wonderful God truly is, and how dependent we are on him. The psalm makes that very, very clear. And so we're to praise. I just want you to notice, I'm going to read these verses, but I want you to notice verse 1 just for a moment here. It says, praise is due to you, O God, in Zion. He tells us in the same verse, and to you shall vows be performed. And so David is talking about praising God. And when he's talking here about Zion, he's really talking about, you know, Mount Zion, a hill outside of Jerusalem. And it was the symbol, so to speak, of the temple. And this temple and hill were seen as the place of connection between God and humanity. And so he, in essence, is saying that he's going to the temple to worship God, to sing praises to him, and he wants us to realize that praise is due God, only God. That's why he refers to God as awesome. Notice even in verse 5, he says, by awesome deeds you answer us with righteousness. He uses the word awe again later in this psalm. And he tells us how, notice verse 8, so that those who dwell at the ends of the earth are in awe of your signs. Now, you know, because I've said this a million times, I'm not going to condemn anybody who uses the word awesome for anything other, you know, outside of God. But for me, I don't use that word except for God. Only God is awesome. Only God do we stand in awe of. And I'm sorry, but I might like pizza, but I'm not in awe of pizza. Or even a great meal. I'm thankful for a great meal. But guess what? I don't refer to it as an awesome meal and stand there in awe of that food. But we ought to be in awe of God, because he's an awesome God. And so the psalmist is focused on how awesome God is and how we are really to come together to worship God and to praise him. So I ask you this question this morning. Did you come into this worship center today with a desire to praise God? If you didn't, you should have. That's why we gather together, to praise God. And you know, I ask you this question. Are you here out of a need to join together to praise God for who he is? And I want you to notice in that first verse this, that when you praise God from the heart, You make promises to him. And so notice he tells us, praise is due to you, O God in Zion, and to you shall vows be performed. Our promises, I think, are only as strong as our praise and worship of God is. Because if we are in awe of him, we make promises to him, we take those promises very, very seriously. And so here's the psalmist talking then about how we're to praise God. We praise God for spiritual provisions, and we praise God for material, physical provisions as well. You find both in this psalm. But clearly he begins by talking about spiritual issues and how we're to thank God for spiritual issues. And so in the first four verses, he says this, we're to praise God for his grace. And in that, he talks about this, that we're to praise God because it's God who saves us. It's God who hears our prayers. It's God and only God who forgives us. And it's only God who can bring us into fellowship with him. Only God can connect us to himself. So I want you to notice, let's read the first four verses. He says this, praise is due to you, O God, in Zion, and to you shall vows be performed. O you who hear prayer, and so we have a God who is great and mighty, who hears our prayers. To you shall all flesh come. So he probably dealing somewhat prophetically here as well, that there's going to be a day when everyone who will know who God is and bow before him. And so he then says, when iniquities prevail against me, you atone for our transgression. Blessed is the one you choose and bring near to dwell in your courts. We shall be satisfied with the goodness of your house, the holiness of your temple. And so what he does here in this psalm is really communicates to us in verse 1 that we're called to worship and make promises to God, commitments to God. But then he deals in verses 1 through 4 with this, that we are to be praising God for his grace, for his mercy, for his salvation. And so what he deals with here is this awesome God and how the grace of God is something that is undeserved. We do not deserve God's grace, and it is something that is extremely radical. And so God's grace is not like any grace that we've seen. Ben read earlier how in the Gospel of John, talking about Jesus Christ, that he was full of grace and truth. My good friend David Anderson and I have been talking about that verse lately. And how even as individuals, we can't be full of grace and not full of truth. And so even on our level, if we're going to be gracious, we still need to be, we need to understand truth. And if you don't understand truth, you don't really understand grace. Jesus Christ, we're told, is totally full of grace and truth. You can't divide them. And so here, David is talking about how awesome God is, how we're to celebrate God's grace. And he talks in verse 2 about kind of this universal need, that everyone needs a Savior. We sang a song something about that. Everyone needs a Savior. And that Savior is the Lord himself. And he talks about the Lord even in verse 5. Notice this. By awesome deeds you answer us with righteousness, O God of our salvation. And so he's focused here on how only God can forgive our sins because he is the God of salvation. He hears us, he forgives us, and only God can forgive us of our sins. Now we kind of look at the whole salvation issue and we think, well, we choose God. Well, he tells us in verse 4, blessed is the one you choose and bring near. Well, I want you to realize that we choose him, we accept him, but the truth of the matter is, the reality is that he chose us and drew us to himself. For this reason, that we are so broken, that we are so sinful, we couldn't even make that decision correctly. But God opens our minds and our hearts to the truth. What truth? Well, the truth that we're sinners. that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And we come to that conclusion that we're all sinners and there is absolutely no way that we can work our way to heaven. And then we understand that Jesus is the only hope of this world and only hope that we have, and that Jesus came to this earth to go to the cross, to suffer and to die, to shed his precious blood, to pay for the penalty of our sins, that when we accept him, we have the forgiveness of our sins and the hope of eternal life. You see, you and I need to realize this hard fact. And this is hard for a lot of people in some religions. It's hard for them to accept this. And here it is. You don't contribute anything to your salvation. You just accept it. There's no way that we work to get saved. And so what we read then, even in the book of John, let me read a couple verses that John penned. Jesus is actually the one speaking. But first of all, in the Gospel of John in chapter 6, here's what Jesus says in verse 44. No one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him, and I will raise him up on the last day. And then in chapter 15, Jesus is talking again. And in chapter 15, here's what he says in verse 16. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you that you should go and bear fruit and that your fruit should abide, so that whatever you ask the Father in my name, he may give it. So what we need to understand is this, that we are to praise God for his grace as it relates to salvation. God accepts us and brings us into a relationship with him. And what these verses tell us is that he doesn't make us just guests of his court, so to speak. He actually makes us children and heirs. You see, that is grace. And so I was thinking about this yesterday. Contacted Elijah, and I said, Elijah, can you do something a little different for us Sunday? And I was thinking about this song as I was reading Psalm 65 and thinking about communion as well. He realized that today, as a communion service, we're celebrating. What are we celebrating? Well, we're celebrating a number of things, but one of the greatest things we celebrate at communion is the grace of Almighty God. And so it's a celebration. And I was thinking about this song that we often sing here. This is Amazing Grace. Here's what the refrain says. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You lay down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Now, if I could, I'd lead you in that song. But I'm thankful I've got two guys to help me. And I'm going to ask you to sing, because right now we're going to sing as a praise to God focused on his amazing grace. Thank you.
Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Seated, and I hope that that's from your heart today, that you're praising God for his grace, just like David of old did. Well, I want you to notice also that David praises God for his greatness. It begins in verse 5, "By awesome deeds you answer us with righteousness, O God of our salvation. The hope of all the ends of the earth and the farthest seas, the one who by his strength established the mountains, being girded with might, who stills the roaring seas, the roaring of their waves, the tumult of the peoples, so that those who dwell at the ends of the earth are in awe of your signs. You make the going out of the morning and the evening to shout for joy." And so David here is praising God for his greatness. He's not only celebrating God's grace, but he's celebrating God's creative power here in these verses. In verse 5, he says this, "By awesome deeds you answer us with righteousness, O God of our salvation." Now, the Bible says here, the hope of all the ends of the earth. I want you to realize this, that really the verse could be translated, should be translated this, "You are the hope of all the ends of the earth." You see, God is our hope. He's the hope of the world. Man looks all over the place for hope, but hope is only found in God. And so there's a prophetic aspect to this as well, that someday all will come and know who God truly is, and they will bow at the name of Jesus. And we need to realize from verse 2, from verse 5, that all war, conflict, injustice, strife will someday end. There will be a great ending to God's plan. And so it will extend to the farthest ends of the earth. And so you and I need to realize that these verses teach us as well that God loves diversity. And so I want you to notice that God works across all kinds of boundaries. And so when he talks about the ends of the earth and the farthest parts of the earth and so forth, and talks about how all will come in essence before God, I think what we need to realize is this, that God works across every boundary that you and I can come up with. He works across the boundaries of nations. He works across race and language and ethnic origin. He works across geographical areas. He goes across all different boundaries and divides that we come up with. And so I think that what he's telling us here is this, that he's not only the God of Israel, He's not only the God of the United States of America, he's the God of every nation. And so all are equal in his eyes. And so with God, diversity is rich. When we read about diversity, even in heaven, in Revelation chapter 7, we read about how before the throne of God, we all come together, and it's from people from every nation and tongue and language, etc. And so, as it is in heaven, may it be here on this earth. I think going to a church and having a church that is really multicultural is preparing us for heaven. And you and I need to realize that we need to be demonstrating God's care and love for all. And so, in my mind, the ideal is not to have a white church or a black church or a Burmese church or a Cuban church, but it is having a church like heaven where we are a gathering place for all nations and people to come together to worship the true and the living God. And so what David does here then, after talking about really the diversity that God has, he talks about how the mountains show God's power and might, verse 6. God is behind everything. He talks about the waves and, you know, how unbelievably powerful the waves are, yet it is God who can silence even the waves, and he can silence the people as well. And so with that in mind, we stand in awe of God's power when you look at his earth. When we think about sunrises and sunsets, God is behind it. And it should bring joy in our hearts and praise on our lips. Well, last, verses 9 through 13, he praises God for God's goodness. He celebrates not only his grace and his creative power, but he celebrates God's benevolence. So notice beginning in verse 9, you visit the earth and water it. You greatly enrich it. The river of God is full of water. You provide their grain, for so you have prepared it. You water its furrows abundantly, settling its ridges, softening it with showers and blessing its growth. You, meaning God, you crown the year with your bounty. Your wagon tracks overflow with abundance. The pastures of the wilderness overflow. The hills gird themselves with joy. The meadows clothe themselves with flocks. The valleys deck themselves with grain. They shout and sing together for joy. And so he's celebrating God's benevolence. Now, when you read scripture, both Old and New Testament, you have to understand that they were living more in an agrarian kind of society than we do today. And that they were societies that view wealth, especially coming from cultivating the land. They understood the importance of agriculture and farming. And so if you grew up on a farm, you should thank God, because you probably have a greater understanding of what even the psalmist is saying here. And so what he's focused on is this, that, you know, where do we even get our food? Well, it's from God. So if you were to ask, you know, people today, where do you get your food? Wegmans. Where do you get your milk? Burn dairy. I mean, I don't know. And seldom do people in this forsake God kind of society, would they say, well, we get it from God. And so here, though, the psalmist, especially in verse 11, recognizes God's hand in the harvest. That God is the one who waters and fertilizes the earth. He is the one who brings cycles of growth and fertility. And so he's praising God for his benevolence. My wife and I had three of our grandkids this week. And so if we look a little tired, that's the reason. God gave you younger couples kids at your age for a reason. We get tired as we get older. But I was reminded this week with our grandkids how much even my kids, when they were young, ate and how much they love food. And, you know, wherever we were, they were concerned about what are we eating. And I remember it brought back memories of when our kids were young, but I remember, I was thinking this week, we're in the car after we stopped at a buffet where they ate and ate and ate, and we're on the way home, and one of my grandkids says, "So was that dinner?" And I'm thinking, are you kidding me? Was that dinner? You know? And, you know, we'd get home, or after a meal, they'd say, "Well, are we going to have a snack tonight?" You know, and so forth. And I thought, you know, I should have asked them, where do you think food comes from? Because I think that sometimes, you know, we neglect even to teach our children lessons about where their food comes from. And they're such great opportunities to help them to understand that regardless of where you buy it, it's God who gives it to you. And so here is David praising God for his goodness, how God cares for the planet, and you know, how God is someday going to deliver creation from all the hurt of evil. And so here's my conclusion, that as we think about David and we think about how we're to praise God for his grace, celebrating his grace, how we're to praise God for his greatness, celebrating God's creative power and might, how we're to praise God for his goodness and celebrate his benevolence. Here's two issues that I want you to think about. First of all, I hope that you focus your attention on God's blessings. I hope that you think about how everything that you have been blessed with really comes from the hand of God. I hope that if you can't name them very quickly, that you search for them, that you maybe even count your blessings. I was at a banquet earlier this week, and a young lady gave a little talk. And she's a very, very young woman. She's lost all of her hair. Her life, in a sense, has been turned upside down. And she has cancer. And so she gave this little talk, and she told how she grew up in a very religious home. And now, as she's going through all these different treatments and so forth, that every once in a while she starts to feel sorry for herself. But she said this, in growing up in a very religious home, she says there was a song that she and her brother had to learn even as little kids. And every time now, when she starts to feel sorry for herself, that song comes into her mind. You know what the song is? Count your blessings. Name them one by one. And it will surprise you what the Lord has done. And so you and I need to make sure that we focus our attention on God's blessings, his grace, his greatness, his goodness. We need to be thankful for and praise God for everything. And then second, we need to practice gratitude every day. We need to praise God in our hearts and in our minds. Maybe it's helpful to write them down sometimes, but it's also helpful to communicate them to other people. The things that we are truly thanking God for. Throughout this week, I hope that you thought about the one saying that I gave you last week. I know I continued to think about it this week. What if you woke up today with only the things you thanked God for yesterday? What would you have? Well, today is communion, and I was thinking about, you know, there's really no better chapter in the Bible for us to think about and dwell on as this Psalm 65. Because it's a psalm that's focused on celebrating. Communion is a celebration. It's a celebration of God's grace, salvation, which he's provided for us. It's a celebration, Paul talks about in 1 Corinthians, it's a celebration of community. As we gather together around the Lord's table, we celebrate community, that we're part of the family of God. It is a celebration of God coming again, because we're told even by the Lord that we do this in remembrance of him until he comes again. And so we celebrate today. I will be in Miami, Florida in a week or so, and I will be spending 2 days with selected pastors and Christian leaders from across the United States. And I was asked to conclude this event by doing communion. And I clearly accepted it. And so I've been thinking about communion and how we celebrate God's goodness. And how we're so broken and sinful that God's grace is so needed to open our minds and hearts to his truth. And to think about how today we're celebrating the love of Almighty God, when we realize that for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. We celebrate our salvation today. We celebrate that Jesus was willing to come to this earth, so graciously willing to allow his body to be battered and bruised for us. And that in grace and love, he allowed himself to be so battered and bruised that he shed his precious blood and gave his very life to pay for our sins, that we might someday be with him. As I sat yesterday on my deck thinking about this message and communion and doing communion with all of these pastors in Florida, I thought of another song. And here's the stanzas I want you to think about as we conclude. It says this in a hymn that we've often sung here, "Here I Am to Worship." I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. And so what? Here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful for me. Lord, I pray that as we partake of these elements today that represent your body and your very blood and life, that it might be in our hearts and minds that we're celebrating that we have a God who is so gracious that he chose us, that he allowed us to see our need and put our faith and trust in Jesus. I pray that this aspect of this service might be a true time of worship and celebration. Lord, may we be so taken with your grace today, your greatness and your goodness, that we sing praise to you, that we celebrate the life that we have in Jesus our Savior. Lord, with David, help us to praise you for your grace. Help us to praise you for your greatness. Help us to praise you today for your goodness, your benevolence to each and every one of us. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're all together lovely, all together worthy, all together wonderful to me. King of all days, oh so highly exalted, glorious in heaven above. Humbly you came to this earth you created, all for love's sake became poor. So here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're all together lovely, all together worthy, all together wonderful to me. And I'll never know how much it costs to see my sin upon that cross. So here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that